got to see the system turned upside down. And I think if it happens, then it's going to be, ultimately it has to be for the good, I think. Just be the changes you want to see in the world. And if enough people do that, we can get a tipping point. First and foremost, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all else will be added onto it, as another way of looking at it. Because if we can put at the top of the agenda our spiritual awakening, but from that, it compels us to want to help others. And by compelling us to want to help others, then we can also have our influence upon society.
I'd like to welcome to the show Craig Hamilton Parker. How are you doing, Craig?
Hi, Alex. I'm doing fine, thanks. Yeah, it's nice to see you.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to talk to you, my friend. Your work is pretty remarkable, and you know, the stuff I've seen on YouTube and what you're doing in the world, and you've been at this for a few minutes.
Most of my life, which is goes into centuries nearly, I think that feels like it. Yeah, but a long time. Yeah.
You were doing the work that you're doing in a time where it wasn't very cool or accepted to do the kind of work that you were doing. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. Yeah, I had to keep quiet about it, actually, completely. Because my early work is a medium, which is, you know, like a person that communicates with the spirit world, particularly here in the UK, was sort of seen upon as being a little bit oddball, you know. And I was working at that time in had my own sort of advertising type of organization sort of thing. And I thought, oh, my God, I dare not let customers know what's going on with this, because if they know that I'm doing this sort of thing, you know, they'll throw me out the boardroom, you know. So I had to keep up. Live two lives with it, really. And I was also a single parent, and all that sort of thing could be thrown against you as witchcraft and things, because in those days, you know, if you're a medium, this was necromancy. I mean, on the BBC would always treat anything to do with mediumship as necromancy. It's still under those rules, actually, even to this day, I believe. Which is a fair different from the way we try to help people and give proof of life after death and things. So I used to, you know, I lived in the south of England, but I used to drive all the way to London to do my readings and things all the time. I kept it well away from home. So, you know, I'm glad things have changed. But only a few of us would be the mediums in those days, because other people had similar things. You know, it could affect your career. It could affect your standing in the world. You know, it was a negative in many respects.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm. So what was your life like before you decided to come out of the psychic closet, before your ability started to come into play? When did you first start about it? When did they first come into play?
Well, I kind of had it since I was a child, really, because I used to see things. I was a single parent, like I said, you know, so it was quite a difficult period for me when I was sort of on my own, working hard, trying to run a business and everything like that. I met a medium called Doris Stokes, who was a very famous medium here in the UK in the time. She became big name in Australia. Not so big in America, really, but I went to a private reading with her, and she saw this happening with me becoming a medium. So I suppose I was in my early 20s, 21 sort of time, 22. And for me, it seemed absolutely preposterous, because I was getting on in the world doing all these materialistic things, I suppose. But I always had a real interest in the spiritual. I used to find I was very telepathic and things. I used to be able to read people's minds. I used to go into meetings and things, and I know exactly what they had in mind for the job they were going to give me or not, you know, and things like that. So it was kind of handy in that respect. I never really understood the idea of mediumship, and Doris Stokes communicated with the spirit for me and told me incredible things, names and addresses of people. My daughter at that time, as a baby, had been taken from the nanny and disappeared somewhere. She gave me the address where to go, and I could send the police there and everything. It all worked out. Mind-boggling stuff, and that kind of flipped me, really. I thought, I'm getting interested in this. This is just too important a thing to get. It was just so interesting, and strangely enough, within a few weeks of having seen her and adding this kind of life-changing experience for me, because we see or hear about it now. It's completely new to people then. You didn't know about spiritualism and all these things. But within weeks, I went to see another medium who'd been an ex-police officer, Peter Close. He actually went over to America and became quite well known in some parts of California. Lovely man. But he was a police sergeant. And he said in his authoritative way, this is the second reading I'd had. And he says, I want you to sit in my circle. I'm being told by spirit, you've got to do this work. You're going to give up everything you're doing and you're going to do this work. And he was bang on right, because I gave it all up and became a medium. And well, it's a long story because, also when this happened, when I was went to see Doris Stokes, she told me about my future wife and who she'd be. And she gave the name. She said, your future wife's name will be Jane Wallace, she said to me.
Jeez.
Well, I sat in the circle and developed my mediumship, but years later, 9 years later, because she said, you'll meet Jane Wallace and her name, it will be the 9th of March that you'll meet her. Well, 9 years later, on the 9th of March, I'm in a spiritualist church giving a demonstration of mediumship. I come to the lady in the back. I've got someone here. I've got the name Wallace with me, right? I've got a spirit person connecting with me called Ethel Wallace, which was, and that was her grandmother. I said, Ethel Wallace is connecting with you. And then it all turned out basically that it was exactly what was predicted. It was the 6th of March. I didn't forgotten it by then. I checked it up on the tapes later. And her name was Jane Willis. But her grandmother, who I was communicating with on the spirit side, was Wallace. So it was like we were match made, I feel, from the spirit world.
Wow.
And when those sort of things happened, when I met Jane, I thought, well, I'm going to give up advertising. I don't care about the money anymore. I just don't, we got enough to make a start. And I went from, meeting the executives at big banks and airline companies and all sorts of stuff. I sort of threw it away. Next thing I'm doing tarot readings. And seeing, have we got enough money to make a pint of milk? Can we scrape by? I mean, it was quite a flip in one's life,
It was
quite a flip.
it's a calling. It is a calling to do the
It
work that you
is.
do. It's a calling, and that's I always love people who, because people always ask me, because I speak to, psychic mediums and channels and people that do this kind of work, and people always ask me, they go, do you think this is all real? Or I mean, I've always been scammed, but I think they're a scam or this or that. And I go, listen, there's easier hustles out there, man. I mean, if like I've said before, like if you're a psychic medium and you're working at a carnival and nobody knows who you are and you're kind of like a gypsy-esque person who just goes from town to town, there's potential there to be taken advantage of. But someone like yourself who's writing books, put yourself out there, you're publicly done, like for years doing it at a time that it was even much, much harder than it was now. There's got to be something going on there that makes sense.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's an absolute, it's a holy office, actually. Because I think when you get, for me, I just felt I got to do this. It's just too important. I mean, to be able to help, when you start seeing how it can flip people's lives around completely, how it can save someone's life sometimes if they're on the verge of suicide, or if somebody's lost a child, or been through something that is just inexplicably bad that we know most people couldn't understand. In a few seconds, sometimes you can do years of positive work that might have taken the years of psychiatric study. And not only that, it's also the you start to want to learn more about it. You want to understand, what is my purpose here? What is the meaning of my life? Why have I been put on this planet? And is this the end of it? Because I think when you get that kind of bigger perspective and you see the big picture, as it were, when you look at the world as being, it's not just when we die, because a lot of people think, oh, well, I'll be dead when that happens, blow everybody out. So I'm dead, I'm dead. They can all put up with the consequence of the bad things I've done in life. You start to get a much more naturally moralistic view of life. You want to sort of think, well, I want to do something that's going to leave happiness behind me. And I want to do something that's going to help me to progress in life as well as help others, because it's all part of the spiritual journey. It's the next level soul. I mean, we have to find the meaning and purpose of our existence. And few people think about that. But I think when you do have the when you do have the absolute certain and absolute knowledge that life continues, the personality continues after death, it changes something in you fundamentally.
Absolutely.
You know, ask anybody that's had a near-death experience. You know, ask anybody that's really had seen and known spirit with absolute proof. And you think, well, you know, it's not a question of what I believe now; it's what I know. You know, and I think that's for many of us that take this path.
Yeah, and you know what? I'll tell you something that I completely agree with you. And you know, when I was before I got into the work that I'm doing, and before I had experiences that I've had in my spiritual experiences that have drawn me into the path that I'm on right now, because just like you, this was not an easy choice to kind of leave my entire filmmaking career behind, leave two other very popular podcasts that were putting food on the table, to jump into a spiritual podcast where I interview psychic mediums, channels, quantum physicists, and things like that. It wasn't an easy path. It wasn't an easy path for me. And I actually pulled back a lot of times because it was scary. It was scary. I thought, same as you, I thought people were like, oh, this guy's lost his mind, he's gone crazy, all this kind of stuff. But once you understand that it's not a, I believe that there's another, that life goes on. I personally completely know that. I've had experiences in my own life. I didn't die and come back, but I've had experiences in my own life where it's been proven to me multiple times, again and again, that there is something else. What that is exactly, I have a general idea. From talking to people like yourself and near-death experiences and all that, the exact thing, I don't know. How it works exactly, I have broad strokes. But there is something. And there's a level of comfort in that that is it's unexplainable. And I think that's what you were talking about. It's just unexplainable. It changes your perspective on life. It changes how you look at things. If you're not walking around with fear of like, oh, if I die tomorrow... Well, if I die tomorrow, obviously that was the time I had to go. That, you know, it's I kind of like let that go right now. I'm like, no, I have a lot of work to do. I think I'll be okay.
Yeah, I think it brings you a greater deal of acceptance of life, doesn't it? And the
Absolutely.
Troubles of life. You know,
yes.
Because half the problem that people have is resistance. People are resisting what happens to them. Everything isn't as it should be for me. Everything is really, you know, everything's bad around me. Everybody's against me. They think all sorts of stuff. But really... The more I travel the spiritual path, I realize that all this business about life after death, this is wonderful. But it's not the whole answer either, because it's not about tea and biscuits in heaven and having, you know, being with your gran in heaven and you know, all this.
Sure.
It's about also what we do in this life and how this life is also something that is in a way of burning our karma as well. Which is vital, but it's also part of our spiritual progress, which has to come through partly through service, because I think that's important. Apparently, by every action we do in the world is as a reaction. So we have to do good deeds in the world. I think we have to do, Christianity kind of teaches that you compassionate acts that you do, but also compassionate thoughts make a huge difference. And also understanding that everything that exists in this world is exactly the same as the afterlife. It's all an illusion. It's all, well, not even that. It's all Brahma. It's all God. It's all consciousness. And then you suddenly think, actually, it's all me. And that becomes quite an interesting thing, because actually what I'm taking with me, you know, I'm not moving through the world. The world's moving through me. And when we start to flow with it and understand that, you know, it don't really matter, you know, nothing can actually harm me. It's all just flowing through me like a river. If we can learn to be not so attached to wanting success or wanting money or wanting love or wanting whatever we want, and we just let it all unfold, we realize that actually is the greatest happiness that can ever possibly be. And to find that is easy, because it's just a matter of letting go of all those things that we think it should be. That we accept the world as it is. And how many people can accept it as it is? Just accept all the pain that's been in one's life as it is. Let it be. All the things that may come in the future, just accept it as the unfolding of karma. Let it be as it is. And that level of acceptance, I think it's the secret sauce. You know, I think it's the way through to handle suffering and to see that suffering is just part of that unfolding. And not to run from suffering, not to try to escape this world, or not to, but just acceptance. And that's completely opposite to everything I learned in advertising and school and everything like that, where you do the complete opposite, you know. Doesn't mean we have to sit back and be lazy all the time and just say, oh, it's all going to happen. We still have to have action. We still have to have free will. But, you know, when but if we take the right attitude to it, we float down the river and we also steer the ship. And I think that's the spiritual path that we have to learn.
And most of us are walking
going around on too much. Sorry.
No, absolutely not.
I shoot off on these raps.
I love this. This is great. And the thing is that most of us are walking upstream against the current in life. And that's why it's so difficult. Yeah. I learned that in my 20s. I was like, if you keep walking up the stream, you're going to get tired. You're going to get weaker and you're going to eventually fall. And the stream's going to take you where it's going to take you.
Sooner or later.
So why don't you skip all of that, sit down, relax, and then just go where the stream goes, but you're driving it. It is a force pushing you down a certain way. It's like I always tell people, I'm like, you know, you and I, Greg, are not going to play NBA basketball. We weren't built for that. You know, we're not, you know, 7'10" with athletic abilities. Maybe you did another life, I'm assuming, for you, sir. I apologize for being assumptuous.
I don't even know what former basketball is.
Exactly. So you and I have a choice if we wanted to go down that road. You know what? You and I have free choice to start. Okay, you know what? I think I'm going to work out. I'm going to start going doing that. But it's not the path we're going. So that's going against that river, going against that current. But when you're like, no, let's just sit down and see what unfolds in front of us, what opportunities are full of, what people you meet, and not be afraid of it all. That's when things start to really, really open up. Like I truly, when this show started, I had no attachment to outcome. I was like, I'm just going to do the work and I'm just going to effort. Like you were saying, you got to do the
effort with effortlessness combined. Actually.
Exactly.
And also important to be wide awake too, because this is the other thing, because most people live in a complete sleep and they deliberately try to push themselves into a sort of a somnambulist sort of state. They're sleepwalking through life. But the more you consciously try to wake up, and the more you consciously do sadhana, or you might do yoga or meditation, or I work a lot with lots of stuff. Loads of stuff in India that's been massive for me in my life, even bigger, I suppose, than the spiritualist type of stuff. But when you consciously do your dharma, all the problems of the world kind of start to drop away, because I get the feeling that suffering comes into your life to sort of say, come on, wake up. You know, if you don't do something about this, we'll throw something nasty at you. You know, right. So if you, it's all about waking up. But what is that waking up? It's actually becoming, it's allowing love to flourish in yourself. It's actually the flower, because that's all it is at the end of the day. Everything I say, it's all Brahma. It's all love. It's all truth and love. It's a bliss. That's all it is. But the problem is we fall asleep all the time. We think it's something else. We think it's I'm going to be happy when I meet Mr. Right or Mrs. Right. Oh. I'm going to be happy when I got the money. I'm going to be happy over there, not over here, you know? So it's being here now, isn't it? Again, it's the idea of being one with it and loving it and enjoying it. And then if we just follow that path, it all works out. That's all it is. That's the absolute answer. There's no goal. It's here already. We are awakened beings.
Yes, without question. There is an interesting phenomenon that happens when you are starting to see it in yourself. When you get to a certain level in your life, I can start seeing it in other people's journeys, where they come to me, they're in my path, or friends, and they're going through the exact same thing I went through, and I can see it so clearly. I'm like, I'm really tired of my job. Well, why don't you start your new business? Oh, well, this or that, I'm having excuses. I'm like, I warned them a year earlier, you really love doing this and you're afraid of doing it. And if you don't do this, the universe is going to keep making things tougher and tougher and tougher and tougher till you're forced to do this, because this is the path you're supposed to be walking. And I can literally see a friend of mine is going through it right now. And I've been pushing her and pushing her and pushing her to do, like, I need to start my business. I'm like, every day, every time I see her, how's it going? How's it going? And then I literally start seeing what's happening at her job. Her job started to twist and starting to tweak the pressure and torque her to a point. I'm like, she's starting to get more and more uncomfortable. And it's fascinating to watch. So now she's actually moving a little bit more, but the universe literally is tweaking. That new supervisor shows up. that doesn't work with you, or this new job situation, or it just keeps pushing you in the direction that you have to go. And I think that works in all aspects of our lives, but it's fascinating to be able to recognize it finally, because I was that person for such a long time.
Yeah, but the thing is, what happens is, you see, those are like loops, and we get stuck in these karmic loops.
Yes.
So often people go through the same issues again and again and again. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's like a spiral. We're back, but slightly higher up, but we're in the same position that we were before, sort of thing, you know. One of the problems people have, and all of us have, and one of the things we have to address is how to break those loops, because mm-hmm. some of those loops are also caused by karma. And mm-hmm. this is where, you see, I know you had on the show one of my friends, Dr. Q, who is also into, like I am, into the nadis, right?
Yes.
And I started to go to India. I sat with some of the sitar yogis, there was one yogi could sleep in a fire, for example, that I went there with, and had incredible clairvoyance and things. And I start thinking, well, actually, India's got all this as well, but it's in a different form. I mean, in India, they say they're fascinated with me because I can talk to the dead, but I'm fascinated with them because they have siddhi powers, as it were. And I investigated and looked into the nadis, which are this is going right back before the days of the internet. I started to look into this, and they, as you would have seen on your other show, I'm sure you put a link to it, but there was all the incredible, it tells you the history of your life, it tells you what mm-hmm. will happen to you, it gives your mother's name, your father's name, and I so I've been very, very deeply involved in that too. And so I kind of combined in my life the idea of using mediumship and communication with the spirit world, but also I kind of, in a way, in communication with those in the past, because I've got so linked into this and spent so many years tied into this idea that these guys that conquered time, that were able to know exactly what's going to happen to each person that ever thinks about them, almost, that these are superhuman levels of clairvoyance as well. So what we actually, most people are doing with their clairvoyance and mediumship is on a quite a low level, really. What we've really got to do is go to these levels that they had in the earlier yugas, as they call it, the earlier ages. Okay. And they left the trails for us. They left the seeds so that we, as we come out of this age of darkness, we can, each of us, all of us as individuals, connect to these incredible little clues that they've left for us to help us to awaken and become, I think, all of us ultimately will have these powers. All of us will awaken to this idea of being capable of all sorts of things. I think as we evolve, we'll be capable of things like materialization. We'll be capable of easy telepathy. We'll be capable of being able to be aware of this world and the next and the other planes of existence and the other levels where other beings live on other planets. It all works through this connection with this energy, this universal mind that we're all living in all the time, but we've forgotten. We've just fallen asleep.
You know, you mentioned, galactic scenario in regards to, you know, creatures on other planets or beings on other planets. And I found that as I went deeper down the Eastern philosophies, the Eastern teachings, like Yogananda, Babaji, that whole lineage, and you start going down those worlds, that's kind of known and has been known for thousands of years. I mean, the Bhagavad Gita, if that's not, you know, otherworldly blue, you know, avatar people that decided to show up.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. It's part of their culture, the beings from another planet or beings from another part of the universe. It's kind of just been a thing where we in the West are, I think, honestly starting to open up to that idea a lot more with the UAFs now and the government kind of coming out here in the States. Hey, man, there's something going on. We know there's something going on. These people, we don't know what these things are, kind of thing. But I'd love to hear your point of view on that from a spiritual place, you know, and how do you think that's going to impact humanity's consciousness as we get closer and closer to that awareness?
Yeah, because I really do believe that we're going through tough times. I mean, I think anybody would look at the politics and the wars in the world. We're coming out of the darker age. But as we come out of the darker age, we enter into a new form of consciousness. And this is where there's hope. As we come out of that darker age of and into an age of greater understanding and awakening, we start to realize, I think, first of all, that our thoughts are not limited to our own heads, as it were. This is something I think that you learn first and foremost as a medium. And when you feed telepathy, thoughts have wings. They go out and they can connect with people. But also thoughts can influence the whole world around us. It can influence events that happen to us. It can influence the karma that's in our life. And good thoughts can open up wonderful things in our life. But also those thoughts can also connect with other people's thoughts. We're in an internet. It's a spiritual internet. We're in a mycelium that it all connects throughout the whole universe. And beings in different worlds can connect with this world. I know we can connect at the moment to the spirit world. I don't believe a lot of what comes through from people who say they're already in contact with people from other planets. A lot of that, I think, is a bit suspect. I've got to say, I feel some of it I worry about. But I think, in theory, we can. It's certainly written in, I'm very interested in the Nadi leaves. And some of these, when people have their readings sometimes, we quite often find in the leaves references to other planets. So these were leaves that were written thousands of years ago. These were oracles written thousands of years ago. And it's all there. It's all mentioned. They talk about the world of the snake people. They talk about the Naga. This is something I just recently did a video on, actually, so it's on my mind. But we talk about that there was a war between the Earth and the Nagas, that they kind of were our helpers originally. They gave us knowledge, but then we abused that knowledge and we destroyed them with the knowledge they gave us. So we were the ones that caused the problem. There's lots of stories about this, and you find little references to it in the Bible, in Sumerian texts, in alchemy, all types of things. There's references to it, so it's definitely there. But the danger is these things, you can also get so carried away with fantasy, and that's where the danger starts to come. You know, because I met some real wacky people doing it. You know, I remember I was really put off once. As a girl that was in contact with aliens, and she'd be speaking in a high squeaky voice like this. Mm-hmm. Oh God, time to go. So we got to keep ourselves common sense with it as well, and try to remain grounded with these things as well, because it's such a messed up field where people have got running off in different directions with things. You know, I think one day we will know, but I always say to people, don't ever trust somebody else's experience. Only trust your own experience, even if it's a holy man or Jesus or anybody. Only trust your experience. Always go direct to the boss. It's you've got to go to God, not whatever that might be. Actually, that's a difficult word, but you've got to realize it for yourself. Not listen to. Don't mimic other people. Don't place your opinions on other people. You've got to do your own thing. You've got to be your own person, and you know that's the way we can get direct communication. I feel,
but direct connection. But Craig, that's scary. That takes a tremendous amount of personal responsibility to do that, where it's a lot easier to give our power away to somebody else. And for whatever reason, there's always somebody else willing to take that power away from you. They're like, you want to give it to me? I'll take it.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, why it's crazy, really, where people are frightened. Everybody wants to sort of control their environment and their world around us. I mean, there's all sorts of people
they're terrified.
Nowadays.
They're control, terrified. They're
yeah, because it's coming from fear. And that's why, of part of the spiritual path, you must have fearlessness, I feel, you know. But and where does that fearlessness come from? It has to come from acceptance, ultimately. You know, you've got to already be dead, as it were. You know, you've got to be like the Spartan that felt that their prediction had been that they will die in such a point, so therefore I can be whatever I want until that point. So they're fearless because they had no fear of death. It's because we have fear of death that we're frightened to live. And this is one of, I think, the great illness of the times that we live in, because everything is trying to keep you away from death. But actually, death is your greatest friend, because if you can understand that everything in this material world is temporary, we then have to see what is real. What are we? And can anything stub out my consciousness? Can anything ultimately stub out my sense of personality? From everything that I've seen, nothing does. It continues after death. So we can live without fear. So if we can live without fear, then why do we have to go down all these crazy paths of denial or have to believe in things? We just have to be it and understand it and let it unfold in ourselves. And, you know, just be, just enjoy this world. You know?
Absolutely. Now, we were talking a little bit about fear, and that is, I think, one of the biggest, afflictions of humanity is fear, fear of the unknown. And I think we're pre-programmed on a physical level to be aware of the tiger around the corner, and you're always afraid of the unknown, and you're always afraid of these things. When you have a little bit more connection to spirit, and like we've been talking about, have a not a belief, but a knowing of what is going on the other side and what our purpose is here and why we're supposed to walk the path that we're walking, fear seems to dissipate. I'm not nearly as afraid as I used to be when I was a younger man. I was terrified about everything. When I was really young, I was absolutely terrified about everything. But now I'm much more mellow about what comes at me, and not as fearful. But there are a lot of people out there who are afraid about a lot of things going on in the world right now. And I wanted to ask your perspective on a few of these things, specifically that right now I found out that 50% of the world's countries are going to have an election this year, or are having election, or have election, which is a great shift in not only leadership but energy around the world, and that could definitely have repercussions, especially in some of the larger, more powerful countries. I'm here in the States. There's one coming up here. I don't know if you've heard or not. There's one coming up
I did
here.
hear about
You
it.
heard about it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But in Europe as well, there's a lot of key elections going
Oh,
on
yeah.
in
We got an
Europe.
election here in the UK right now. Yeah.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly. So there's a lot of big things happening. What do you foresee in these elections of 2024, and how is it going to affect where society is going to be going, at least for the next couple years? Because listen, the last election we had in the U.S. was there was a couple things that happened over here on January 6th, and there was definitely some rumbling, and people are afraid on either side. No one's going to be happy on either side here in the States, and I'm assuming in your elections as well. If
Yeah.
one gets elected, the other side's going to be, oh, it's and it's constant throughout the world. I'd love to hear your thoughts on it, my friend.
Okay. Well, I make a lot of predictions with my work. This is probably where I've got known mostly. I don't always see it as the main thrust of what I do, but that's what's often very popular, of course. And I feel, well, the problems we're having in the world is divisions. I mean, we've come in a very big steps out of a time when nobody communicated with each other into a time when communication is everything, and a time when, artificial intelligence is coming onto the scene too, which is going to completely distort everything we know about ourselves and the world. And this is all with the changing of the eras, as it were. But the divisions are coming, and the problem is we got far left, far right over here in the UK, and the same Democrat and Republican extremism, really, basically. And the way I see it happening, part of it has come because of complacency. There's been so much corruption in the governments around the world, so much hidden influence from places like China in particular. I feel things like COVID, for example, there was a hidden agenda behind all those things. I think most people think that and feel that. And we're not be and everything has been corrupted. Everything, all the big companies have behind things all the time. So what people are hoping for and looking for is a voice. They want a voice. So somebody like Trump, I feel, is going to become the next president of America. I see it. I saw it before. I predicted Trump would become president even before he was up for election.
If you're enjoying this conversation, I invite you to go deeper down the rabbit hole with me on Next Level Soul TV. It's packed with exclusive content like live special guest Q&As, daily podcasts, commercial-free access to the entire Next Level Soul catalog, early access to episodes before they air, and special meditations you won't find anywhere else. We will be adding new exclusive content every month. Plus, you can connect with me during my monthly live streams. Just go to nextlevelsoul.com/subscribe and join our soulful community today. I'll see you on the inside.
I made a prediction about that that was picked up a lot by the press around the world. And it was on the Unexplained, on that program, The Unexplained. He came into power, and I feel that he was deliberately pulled out of power. And I think he'll come back again, even though, he's not perhaps always seen to be the most highest moral person. But at the same time, we've got those conflicts there. Here in the UK, we've got exactly the same problems we got. Politicians that are managers rather than leaders. And it means that leaders can come to the fore. This is the danger in the world, because there's been so much complacency, so much division, so much lack of cultural identity. You know, I mean, people are losing, like I've got a spiritual center, for example, that we're trying to open in Italy. And in Italy, there's been huge shifts to the right wing over there, you know, and it's a reaction against a lot of immigration coming into countries, huge amounts that so that people can't integrate. So you get multiple societies within the societies. You start to get kind of like ghettos again. So I think the big question that we're all going to have for the future is, how can we find unity within diversity? Because whatever the case, we have new peoples in our countries. We have divisions of thought between countries. There's going to be these divisions. And it is really important that we find some way of finding unity and diversity. And that's where we've got to start looking for our commonalities. That's why we've got to start to looking for what is it that makes us all human. That where we've got to start thinking we're spirits in body, and that's it. We're all spirit. We're all the same. So the answer has to come from a spiritual standpoint. The only way we can bridge these things is through spirituality. And that's why I feel that something's going to happen. There's going to be something huge in the world that's going to happen on a spiritual level. I feel that this is, I don't think of it as like a second coming type of thing, but I see it as like multiple people incarnating on the earth simultaneously, who are the awakened beings again. Awakened beings are going to start to reincarnate, and that will change everything. It will happen in my lifetime, I believe. So it's on its way. It might even be here already, but I have a very, very strong feeling about this. And this will bridge the terrible crisis we are in at the moment. A crisis of not knowing who we are, a crisis of weakness that comes through endless looking at screens and internets, a weakness of a loss of our sense of personal identity, a loss of sense of national identities, an undermining by so many negative forces. I see China as a negative undermining force. I think there's many undermining force in corporate business. And we got to pull ourselves out of it. But all the great flowerings in history, when there's been a spiritual awakening, have often been at times like this, have often been at times when there's been a sense of something's not quite right. And Buddhism came when Hinduism was in a terrible state and there was conflict within India. Jesus came at the same time there was all the conflict in the beginning of the fall of the Roman Empire. If you look at any great flowering of awakening, and it always comes at a time of great difficulty. So this, I think, is the darkness before the dawn. Out of this time is going to come something very, very special, and it's going to be a superb time to live in.
Do you see, I mean, I look at the what's going on in our elections here, and I'm down the middle. I don't have a fight in either side, but what I do see is a representation of the old systems that are not serving the people anymore on both sides. And literally the candidates are the two oldest candidates of all time. They were the two oldest candidates 5 years ago, yeah. You know, as
I know,
well.
I know.
So it seems almost insane that I'm like, you mean to tell me there's nobody else on either side that, you know, some sort of fresh blood, some sort of fresh anything. So it seems like these old systems, and I use them as an example, but you could see it throughout every other part of the world as far as companies are concerned, religion is concerned. Like healthcare is concerned, economy is concerned. They're holding on to these old systems, but you're seeing the cracks. I mean, we all see what's happening. We all see the cracks happening. What's your take? What's your thoughts on these old systems that are trying to hold on to power while we obviously know they're not working for us anymore?
Yeah, we're shifting into a new age, and that means we've got to break from the old. The snake has got to shed its skin. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have Trump there in America. I think he has shaken up the complacency. You know, we were talking earlier on about spirituality. We fall into complacency, and that's when danger happens. So you need it shaken up. We have Nigel Farage, who was also spoke at the Trump meetings very much over here, talking possibility. This guy might even one day become prime minister. He's the Western Trump, the UK's Trump. So there's a lot of forces happening in the world because it's got to be shaken up. And I, like I say, I've predicted that I feel he will become president. And even though many people will really hate him, and I suspect a lot of people that follow your channel won't like me saying this, but I think he will be somebody that will actually be better for America in the end of the day, because you've got to shake the system up. He does what he said. He does what it says on the tin. He go, if he says, I'm going to drain the swamp, that's what he's going to do. But to use the legal system to stop him, because it's self-evident from everybody seeing it from overseas. We see it and he said, this is all stitch-ups. This is stitch-up. And the more you try to stitch someone up, the more you'll get people on your side, actually. It backfires. So I think we've got to see the system turned upside down. And I think if it happens, then ultimately it has to be for the good, I think, because the pendulum always swings. If it goes that way, it'll swing back the other way again. But the problem is we have too much levels of division at the moment, and the bubble's got to burst, and it'll be uncomfortable. It'll be unpleasant. It'll cause lots of people distress. But I think ultimately it's something that has to happen around the world. And the fear is, of course, we've seen it happen before in history, and it can go to terrible extremes. So let's hope that we can somehow find a middle way. And that's why I think our necks are all saved by spiritual awakening. I mean, what can we do about it? We all feel helpless when it comes to voting. We all feel as if our vote never counts. We don't know if it's even been counted sometimes. So what can we do? Well, Gandhi always used to say, be the changes you want to see in the world. And yes, that's always, I think, is a good way of looking at it. Forget about politics. Forget about left and right and Democrats and the rest of it. Forget about what's what. Just be the changes you want to see in the world. And if enough people do that, we can get a tipping point. You know, you've got people like in the background, I see in your background there, you've got Yogananda and Babaji and people like that in the back. I mean, they knew what was going on. They transcended the normal world. And they would say the same thing to us, wouldn't they? Be what you are. Be who you are. Focus on that. And the more of us that do that, I think we will ultimately shift the nature of things. Because at the end of the day, all these material things, they don't matter at all. They're all out there. They don't. Really? They're secondary. News has become entertainment. News has been something that's forced on us 24 hours a day. We don't need that. We forget that we're here for a different purpose than that. We're here because we're here to awaken. We're here to become spiritual beings. We're here to understand the nature of our existence, to clear our karma and awaken to the wonderful truth and love of what we truly are. And if we focus on that, I don't think the world can touch us.
Mm-hmm. And I'd agree with you. And the more that we're able to do that, we inspire others around us to do it, and so on and so on and so on, almost kind of infecting them with love and awakening to be able to do that. Because when you meet someone like that and you're not at that, let's say, place in your life, you get inspired. And if you're able to go down the road of finding it within yourself, then the people around you is like, oh, what happened to Jane? Jane looks, what's going on? She seems happy. Well, what is she doing? Oh, and then boom, boom, boom. That's the only way change will happen. When you change within yourself is the key.
Yeah, it rubs off, doesn't it? It rubs off. I mean, and so that's the most we can do, really. Obviously, we try, they say, you know, evil triumphs when good men do nothing. That's also true. We must do our work in the world. We must have our hands in society, but our heads in the forest, as it were. You know, so if we can live that way, then we're living. But ultimately, the head in the forest is the most important part, because that's where our consciousness comes. How can the hands work without the head? So first and foremost, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all else will be added onto it, as another way of looking at it. Because if we can put at the top of the agenda our spiritual awakening, but from that, it compels us to want to help others. And by compelling us to want to help others, then we can also have our influence upon society. And we've got to get it just around. It's simple, really, but we've got to get it around the right way like that. The problem is we're all focused on what's in it for me, what's in it for me. You know, how many of us think what's best for all of us? You know, like money. I always think money's for sharing. People think I'm mad because they think, oh, everyone will take your money, Craig. But it's there for sharing. I want to share it with other people.
It's energy.
If money more of us took that attitude, it carries karma too. So the more you give, the more you get, and it always works. You know? I
cannot agree with you more. Now, one thing I have heard about this next, within the rest of this year and going into the next couple years is that there's going to be an event, something, either be a natural event, economic event, possibly, you know, some sort of, you know, battle or a war or something like that. There's going to be something that's going to cross the line, or that's going to galvanize us to go, we're not going to go down this road again. And that's going to be something that's going to be the thing that pushes us into this new area that we're, this new era that we're walking into. But there has to be something, you know, I joke around. It's like, yeah, it's Independence Day. It's when the aliens park right in front of the White House lawn and everyone goes, wait a minute. And we all join up like, we're all humans. There we have a common foe. It's going to be something similar, but it's going to be a point where we all choose, like, we've been down this road again. We're not doing it. Is that something you see?
Well, I in my nadis, again, because the nadis, like I say, were the leaves that predict your future, and it 100% correct.
And let me stop you there for a second. The nadis, for people who don't understand, are the Indian palm readings. Like, and if you just do a search for Dr. Q, we did a whole episode on this, these amazing ancient oracle palm reading, palm readings on it. So go ahead. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah. So me and Dr. Q, you could go to my site too. They go via to Dr. Q at the same time or whatever. Mm-hmm. But it said in mine when I first looked at these years ago, like I say, and it said, it told me so many things, but it said that you would warn the world about a gas cloud. Now, I feel that something, and I've just been recently doing some work in Japan, and I sense that something is going to happen. I think it's going to be with Japan. I think there's going to be a big earth movement of some sort that is going to be world changing. It will also affect the whole Pacific plate. Now, I'm not quite sure when it's coming, but it said in my 90s it would come in my running age of 71. So I'm 70 now. So I'm in the running age of 71 because they have it running. So I feel something's happening like that. I feel that there's going to be some earth shift. It's completely unexpected. It'll be completely out of, it'll make us really, really think. It'll mean we'll have to stop what we're doing, stop what we're doing, and it could affect the world economies. It could affect everything. And that will be, it will be a good thing, because I remember also when I was first starting out on this path, my teacher used to go into trance and I used to speak to his guide through that. And he said to me, I asked about the prophecies of Nostradamus and things and this sort of thing. And said, would there be a third world war? No, there wouldn't. But he said at that time, and this is 1980, he was saying, but there will be a war between Iran and Iraq that would be a major war. And it would be the small countries like North Korea that would be the problem. At a time it was completely impossible for that to be taken seriously. Those things happened. But the message behind it was, no matter how bad it gets, we'll get through it. So I think there will be some bad stuff ahead, and it will be something like an earth shift of something. Some of the nadis also predict a meteorite, but that goes between the moon and the earth. But I think some of that could be questionable, but I'm not sure. It wasn't in mine. But we'll have some dramatic thing. I think we'll have some dramatic earth event like that that will make us all sit up and take notice and start to think, you know. And the answer in the trance was that the only way we can solve the big problems of the world is when we work together. And by having these big problems, the reason they're there is to make us work together. It's like individually, if you get complacent, something could come along and give you a kick. If as a world we get complacent, something could come along and give us a kick. And the reason we're given a kick is a compassionate kick, because it's a kick to get us back on the path to awakening again, because that's why we're here in the first place.
Beautifully said. So let me ask you about another area that people are really concerned about, is these conflicts that are around the world. There's two major ones going on right now with Israel and Palestine, and also in the Ukraine and Russia. And they've been going on for a minute now, both of them. They've been going, 2 years now, I think, Ukraine, and over a year now with Israel and Palestine as of this recording. And they, again, seem like such old, and I've said this so many times, they seem like old arguments that have been brought back up. I'm like, really? Yeah. Is this still happening? Where do you see those finishing off? Like, I hope that they're going to finish off soon and we don't have like another 30-year war like we did in Afghanistan and the U.S., which it's about 20-some years that we were there until we left. Mm-hmm. But what do you see for those conflicts? And are there any Is there going to have to be any other conflicts coming for us to wake the hell up?
Well, unfortunately, I see them both grinding on. In particular, I've made a lot of predictions about this in my videos and things, but I feel that Israel will ultimately strike Iran. So that's gonna
Oof.
escalate, and I feel that Israel will also move into Lebanon and maybe further. So I feel that that's gonna extend. Ukraine, I don't think that's gonna come to an easy end. That won't come to an end to the death of Putin, who will be followed by ultimately by a female leader of Russia.
No.
And we got another one that's going to be coming up, which is going to be Taiwan, because I was talking about that right way, way back when I first started my channel, saying that I felt that this was going to be a big conflict between Taiwan, because we had an amazing sort of connection here, because there's a ancient old leader of China called Sun Yat-sen. Some of the family came and had a reading with my wife here. So we've always kind of felt connected with the family of Sun Yat-sen spiritually, because he came through in the readings. And I feel that China will ultimately break up into smaller countries, and from it will come a great democracy. Great democracies. It will become like a group of countries like Europe. And ultimately, also, India will rise. It will rise and guide the world. But the teachings of India will be very significant, because it would take a new spiritual view of things. So, all of these things, I think ultimately, this is much, much longer term, but all of these things, I think ultimately, are hopeful. We will sort out ultimately Ukraine. I don't think that will go into anything where there will be a nuclear conflict, because there's always the fear of that, because Putin's always rattling the
Threatening
sabers
it.
with that. He won't dare do that. It will grind to a halt, unfortunately. It'll grind to a halt and a final agreement made. And I think Russia will keep some of the territories, and there'll have to be a compromise. It's like any compromise. Everybody goes away unhappy, and if everybody goes away unhappy, that usually means you've got a proper compromise. I think Israel will go on for a lot longer. I feel Israel is so angry they'll keep going as far as they can until they're stopped. But anyway, we'll have to wait and see. But again, thoughts are things. The way we think about these things also it is important, because it's like world karma. We got to start thinking more in terms of humanity. And if there is a renaissance again, a renaissance of consciousness and renaissance of the arts, which often comes with a renaissance in consciousness, I feel that many of these problems will be easily solved, because we'll start and more and more people will be thinking in a different way. But
I appreciate that. There's one thing that has that a thought that has come into my mind in recent months, and actually within recent years, something that I never thought would ever be possible in my lifetime. It just didn't even comp I couldn't even fathom the idea, but I'd love to hear your thoughts of, the US as an empire has been around for about 300 years and change, really, ever since we got rid of we got rid of those British folk, but
Yeah, they're a problem, English.
the problematic. I mean,
You couldn't shift the
but
Irish, though.
I know we could not, sir. We could not. No, I'm joking. Joking. But as an empire, it's been around for a very short amount of time. I mean, in the grand scheme of our history, even our written history that we know of, I always was, born here. You think, oh, it's going to go on forever. I'm assuming the Romans thought the same thing. I'm assuming the British thought the same thing. I'm assuming the French thought the same thing and everything. Do you see the US doing the same thing that you just said China was going to do? Break up into different territories, countries, maybe still working together, but just breaking up for ideology, for other reasons. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, well, it's obviously the fear is that, because I mean the divisions in America, in
Are
not just
so.
north and south, but east and west. I mean, every direction you look in America, there's problems with this. I think what's the problem has been is that too many of the leaders of both America and Europe and around the world have been managing. They've been just managing things, managing decline. They've got no inspiration. They've got no drive. They've got, most things bring, usually it's wars that bring people together, but fortunately we haven't had any wars, but we have, but not global conflicts in the same level that we would have had in the First and Second World Wars. But the so I think there's a lack of direction and a lack of national identity. And I that's why I think you do need somebody, albeit somebody that's a bit, you know, suspect. I think you also could say with Trump, you need someone that gets people focused again. We need the same in Europe's got exactly the same problem. UK's got all around the world. All around the world, we've got exactly the same problems with people having these loss of faith in oneself, and it happening to individuals as well. We're losing faith in ourselves. You know, I think it will pull together again. I don't think America's going to fall into decline. America was founded on spiritual values, really. I mean, yeah. America was I was born in Southampton, and the Mayflower set forth from Southampton to Plymouth and then to America. And actually, one of my relatives back then was on the boat on the Speedwell. And it was spiritual people going. There's the Pilgrim Fathers and the rest going to America to set up a new spiritual country. And I think that foundation, actually, the seeds are in that. And I feel that the seeds of America will be spiritual again. And I think America's just lost its soul at the moment. It's lost its way. It's lost its sense of purpose because it got lost in materialism, like the rest of the world. We've all got lost in this plastic world we've created, this lazy world we're creating now with AI and things as well, where human intelligence becomes less important. We've got to get back to basics. I think, for example, Yogananda, who obviously you're interested in as well, had it right, I think, when he said that what will happen to America in the future is it will become decentralized. It will become smaller homesteads, that the cities will become less important, that people will start to kind of get back to the land again. A bit sort of hippie-ish, man, but there's some good thoughts in that because we perhaps have got too centralized with everything and we don't necessarily need to be. So, and we can still be a country. We can still be a unified country, but in a different way. Greed has taken control of all our nations. When we get a spiritual awakening again, you know, places like America will come back into harmony. It won't be like this forever. It won't break up into multiple places or war with one another potentially and a weaker force. No, I think it will in China because it always was different nations years, centuries ago. But I think in America, it will remain as one. And America will continue to guide the world and be one of the policemen of the world and will be the leading democratic country of the world. And it will do it hand in hand, I believe, with India, which will have a marked effect on America in the long distance future.
Where do you see the economic, the economies of the world going, the global economies? Because, again, people are terrified of that and what's going on. And as you were talking about greed, my God, the markets around the world, the corporate interests, all this stuff, it has to crack. There has to be a moment that something happens. I've been saying this from anyone who listened to me. I'm like, we are way overdue for another 2008, way overdue. There has to be something. They've been propping up the whole system, and not just here in America, around the world. And whatever happens in America affects the world. Whatever happens in Europe affects the world. If you go down, America's not going to just be like, la, la, la. We're all connected. We're all connected. What do you see for the economic future of where we're at least in the next few years?
Well, I think there will ultimately be a sort of an economic collapse, particularly with cryptocurrencies. I've felt for a long time that these are illusionary things. I mean, people don't study history nowadays, and you only need to look at history. And for right back to the Victorian times here in the UK, we had the South Sea bubble, where everybody invested in the South Sea companies, but there was nothing there. They were just pieces of paper.
We've got exactly the same. Yeah, don't forget the tulips.
But we've got exactly the same problems now. We've got people investing in little electronic chips. I think we're going to get a pop at some point. But I also feel that I think in the longer term, we're going to rethink money in a different way. Now, because we ought to rethink work as well. You know, I mean, this idea of you work Monday to Friday and have Saturdays and Sundays off, that came from the Victorian factories from England originally.
Correct.
And everybody worked and then you had the death. And now we're supposed to have machinery that's going to do the work for us. We're supposed to have AI that's going to do the intellectual work for us. And yet we're still working Monday to Friday. There's something kind of wrong there. Why are we working like that? we're kind of working for the other guys. You know, a few people get greedy and want to take the lot. Most of the world's wealth is in the hands of a few people. So I think there will be a readjustment of some sort. And I think there'll be a readjustment of how we look at money and how we look at work. This is kind of a bit more utopian in my thoughts about these things. But the way money works at the moment, ultimately, is bound for failure. Because it can't work. You can't have continual expansion. Back in the 60s, we were talking about the limits of growth. We were talking about that it can only grow so far. We expected it all by now to have collapsed. It's remarkable it's gone on as long as it has. But sooner or later, it has to topple. And I think there will be a topple with the world's markets. And you know, make sure you've got your money in things that you can see. Property must be something that would probably be resilient. Food mm-hmm. might be useful during those times. And mm-hmm. I think we'll have to rethink. And there will be, and it could be in the next, within the next 10 years, that we see this big reversal of things and a scramble to get things right again. But I think these things often can bring something better out of them. Sometimes, this? You know, we have to kind of go through rebirths all the time. And I always say to people, when people say, oh, we're not going to make it. But I think, well, you know, we've survived ice ages. We've survived the dinosaurs. We've survived we've been here probably longer than, you know, we've evolved more than most creatures on Earth. So somehow we've managed to do it in the past. And I'm sure we'll do it again. And I think once consciousness is, because there's something special about consciousness. It's not something held in the body. This whole universe is here for this evolving of consciousness. Consciousness is what it's all about. That's what the most important single thing in the universe. And consciousness is not going to be wiped out. So humanity or some form of consciousness will continue. And I think once you get conscious beings on a planet, ultimately, that planet will always survive. Consciousness will survive. And that's what it's all about, to create a being that can house consciousness. So it can't go wrong. We can't fail, ultimately, I feel.
Yeah.
It's very optimistic.
I feel you as well, because I feel that I'm very optimistic as well. It's not saying that the road to that optimism is not going to be a little bit bumpy. We're going to have to go through some bumps, and that's what people are afraid of. But it's the conversation we had earlier today. It's like everyone's so terrified of the negative and the positive, and like, oh my God, I'm fearful. If you let things unfold and just do the best you can along the way, you'll be okay. It always works out. Generally speaking, it always works out. And I think in the long term, we're not going to some, you know, dystopian, you know, Mad Max world or, you know, Terminator world or Matrix world. We are not going there. We are more optimistic, but it's not saying that's going to be peaches, you know, and rainbows and unicorns along the way. It's going to be struggle.
And it's how we approach it, isn't it? It's how we live it. The big mistake we make, we've got to live from the inside out, not the outside in. We're all living our lives as if that's where it is. It's out there. My happiness is out there. My love is out there. My people I want, everything's out there. But that's where we've fallen victim. If we can live from the inside, we're balanced within ourselves, we're centered within ourselves, we're at peace within ourselves, we're happy and content within ourselves, then all the things on the outside aren't going to draw us quite so much. We're not going to fall the victim of the illusion all the time. So we've got to live from the inside. And that, if each person can do that, then you'll walk through this life safely, because we're not here for long. You know, we're here at the twinkling of an eye. When you think of the great vastness of time that this universe has been here, we're only here for a fraction of time. So make the best of it. Walk through this world valiantly, without fear and with love. And I think you're always protected, because we're going to step out of this world sooner or later. Death will come to every single one of us. So why fear? Just walk with it and enjoy the being here. Because I think that's also part of it. We must love life. We must enjoy life. And we can get too distracted by all the things that are happening in the news and all the worries that are out there. You know. And so what are we doing? We're forcing our attention onto all those things. Keep the attention on yourself, on the spirit, on the inner self, on the goodness within you, on the love that you can give to the world, and think what you can do for it. More of us become focused like that, you know, we don't need many. And it changes the balance of everything, I feel. And that's why things like what you're doing with this podcast and the rest of it. You know, these are so important because it's bringing together like-minded people, people who want to do some good in the world, people who are thinking about the meaning and purpose of their life. And this become, and the sum is greater than its parts. You know, it becomes a very powerful thing. It becomes like a healing energy to the world. So thank goodness for YouTube and the rest, because this is a way, I think, that we can start to bring about a change of human consciousness on a bigger scale than it's ever been.
Absolutely, absolutely. The one thing, since you were saying about media, essentially what we're doing and how it's affecting the world, there is an old system that I used to work in called Hollywood. And
I heard about that.
You've heard about that system, right?
Yeah, yeah. I heard about it. Yeah.
So that old system of Hollywood, it seems, you know, from my point of view, seems to be struggling badly. It seems the cracks are starting to come down. The old systems are, they're start trying to hold on to the old systems. It seems like it's eating itself alive. I'd love to see, I'd love to hear your point of view on and what you see for that old system of media. And that also includes television, news outlets, that whole thing, you know, mainstream media, which we just use the word Hollywood for. What is going to, what's happening to it now, and how is it going to have a place in the future, or is it going to just fade away in some new form of the next level, the next level, if you will, shows or media will come out to help help us during this new transition?
Well, big things are happening in technology, as you, I'm sure you would be aware. But I mean, some of the things, I'm friends with a number of sort of film directors, and they've been showing me some of the stuff that can be done in artificial environments, where you can put the whole thing in AI in incredible ways. So it's going to mean that we do not have to have the same kind of focus of having everybody all gathered together in LA to make a movie. So this artificial intelligence and this way that we can work with these new simulated environments is going to make the actual process in making movies much easier. Who would have thought that people like us can produce a YouTube channel, edit it all, have all special effects, bring in clips of different bits and pieces and draw it all together and do it all from a single room? You know, it's changed completely. So I think we're going to see an ending of a lot of the stuff that goes with big stars. For example, the artificial intelligence, we're going to be able to map onto people's faces our favorite star, and we can watch Marilyn Monroe forever in every sort of movie if they allow the copyright free of that sort of thing. So we're going to see all sorts of strange ways of interacting with things like that. So I think the days of Hollywood as we knew it are definitely on the fade. And I'm seeing a big shift going to other places that have got the money, particularly some of the Arab states. I feel that some of the big movies are going to start to be produced and made in places like, you know, Dubai and all those type of Arab sort of growing Arab tiger states, I suppose. I don't know what they call camel states. Those sort of places are going to start to escalate. And I think generally the trend actually will be want to get back to more realistic filming, because the whole thing has been so affected by woke that you can't actually watch anything without having political messages put into history and history changed. I think that's wrong. I think we should value history as it was, not try to turn it into something what it wasn't. The Americans are the worst at this, because they won the Second World War in every movie you see. Says me as a Brit. But what? You know, there's too many political messages put into programs, and they're kind of stupid messages. I want to see more thoughtful movies, and I think people will start to hanker for this. I mean, we don't see, you know, if you watch any of the programs on the television or on Netflix and the rest of them, they're also drivelly, and they're just the repeat, almost like George Orwell's novel writing machines. You know, they're just the same stuff regurgitated, and you can get AI to say, right, redo me, you know, write me this book again, write that same novel again. There's only a certain number of stories, and they can churn them out and churn them out. I think we'll get back to a bit more thoughtful movies will start to come. But the big Hollywood blockbusters and things like that, we don't need that anymore. It can all be done by AI. And although we'll have all that, I think we're going to see kind of the movie making side of it as becoming a much more crafted thing in the future, and probably going back to older styles of filming sometimes, so get away from the endless AI. And of course, mainstream media I mean, none of us, this is what's happening with one of the main problems with politics in the world is none of us can trust mainstream media in any country. If you look at the comments that come into, like when I do my videos, the number of comments that come in about the people, oh, you've been watching mainstream media, that's not right, you know. It's become completely lost in the algorithms that's pushing to me all the time what it wants me to see. If I watch a program on one thing, it'll throw me more and more and more. And if I wasn't more thoughtful, I think that's the way the world is. So the danger is the algorithm. And I think what we're going to have to see in the future with media is control of the algorithm, that the algorithm we have to keep locally and not have someone else have our data and have our watching patterns and be able to serve us up stuff until we say we can do it. Otherwise, all of us are going to just be constantly the victims of ourselves, because we watch, say we got some involved in something like Nazism, and we watched a movie about Nazism, then another program, another one comes up, and we think that's what the world's all about. We think everybody's into that. So we get lost and pulled down into a trap of limited thinking. And that's the algorithm doing that. We see it on the search engines, we see it on YouTube, we see
And
it
yeah,
on
on
all
social
social
media.
media. And we'll see it on adverts soon, with adverts targeted to us specifically, with people that would appeal to me to buy it. I see people with my age group or something like that. Very, very dangerous. And I think that's the thing that's really messing up the media, is this algorithm that is telling us what we should be seeing next. And it's because it's not what you watch, it's what you click on, what you're showing. You'll only see what you're showing. So that's where I think the danger, and I think there's going to be lots of changes in that, and there will have to be in the world, particularly with the advent of AI, that's going to track every single thing we're doing, every single place we go, and every place we take our phone. The danger is that the algorithm could become so specific to the individual that we can lose complete track of reality because of it.
Well, it's
So
already happening. That's already
it's
happened.
happening, and this is going to escalate to the point that there has to be global laws to stop this. Otherwise, we're going to be enslaved to the point that, we won't know what's real and what's not at all, at all. And
And
that's a
when that
very, very dangerous position, because we're not even able to make a judgment, because the judgment has been wiped from us. It's,
It's happening now, though, Greg. I mean,
yeah,
look,
this
the
is.
last, I think the last 10 to 15 years with I'd say the last 10 years for sure, with social media like Facebook and these kind of things, that this algorithm, you go into this bubble. And if you watch one thing about the, all of a sudden you just, I think that's where the division has really been created, is
It
because you just
is.
keep, you're like, that guy's bad, that guy's bad, that guy's bad, that guy's bad, that the
Yeah.
Democrats are horrible, the Republicans are horrible, the Democrats are horrible, and it just keeps
I
going,
know.
going, going, going. So you just keep, you're like, well, yeah, every, don't you understand? Everybody feels this way. No, it doesn't. It's
Yeah, that's the problem. Yeah,
fascinating.
whatever
It's
side of
really
the divide
fascinating.
you are, like I might watch Joe Biden falling down the steps of an airplane, right? And next thing you
Sure.
get, Joe Biden gaffes here, this gaff, gaff, gaff. And your whole screen's full of them, chock-a-block, shorts as well as the main videos. And I think, well, what about the other side of the story too? So it depends what you watch, they give you more of it. So it immediately pushes you into an extremist viewpoint, because everybody that's watching is pushed into their own personal extremist viewpoint. So you might be leaning towards one way or the other, but it's pushed far, far further than it should be. And again, this is where we've got to really think about things, I think, in the future. This AI is obviously going to be massive. We're beginning to realize that now, but it could also it could wipe out human choice. It could wipe out democracy, because we're not able to know who we choose. We could be so manipulated that we don't know what's truth and what's not. And again, one more reason to come back to that idea: only trust your own experience. Don't trust the experience of what other people tell you. You've got to go it from your own standpoint, and be aware that all around you, you're being manipulated one way or the other.
Greg, I appreciate everything you've said in this conversation so far. I'm going to ask you a few questions, ask all my guests, my friend. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
But I suppose you feel fulfilled if you feel happy. Happiness is what we consider as being, that's what arises. If we feel fulfilled. And I think happiness is often connected just with, I think, being content, learning to be content, not being lazy, but having inspiration and wanting to do things in the world, but also being content with what you achieve. And I think happiness comes if you always do your best in life. My granddad used to say to me, Craig, whatever goes wrong in life, always, as long as you've done your best, win or lose, if you've done your best, you'll always be happy. And I thought that was a good motto, and it stuck with me all my life. So that's what I feel. That's where it comes from. To do your best, that will always bring it.
Now, if you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Craig, what advice would you give him?
Don't do any clairvoyance.
Get a real job. This is
get a real job, man.
It's a rough hustle, but it's a rough hustle.
I suppose one would say something to the effect of, you know, have no fear, you know, just go through life. Because all, I think I would say to myself in the past, that all the things you worry about never happen. Because they don't. The things we worry about don't usually happen. It's just deal with things that happen instead of worrying about what will happen. And I think that would have saved an awful lot of energy. And I think you'd give yourself another 50 years of life, I think.
Fair enough. How do you define God or source energy?
Well, yeah, that's the worst word in the universe, because it means so much to so many people. Mm-hmm. And when people say, do you believe in God? I say, I have to first define what God is, because I can't tell you what God is. Certainly God is not a man in a chair in the sky type of thing. I don't know whether God is individual awareness. I don't think so. So I think of God as the universe becoming conscious, and us becoming conscious of being part of God. So it's the flowering of consciousness. That's as I understand God. The universe becoming conscious, although it might already be conscious, but it's the process and the result at the same time.
What is love?
Well, love is God. Love is truth. Love is bliss. They are ultimately love. There's two types of love in many respects. There's the love that we have between individuals, which is like the affections between people, the love of a mother to a daughter or a child, a love of to people towards each other. That is one level of love. But there's also a love that's beyond that, that I think is the compassionate love, the selfless love, which is the love of being. And I think when everything in the universe dissolves, when everything is taken away, what remains is pure love, and it's beyond human description. Love is divine consciousness.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
That's a false question in some ways, because it assumes there's a beginning, middle, and an end. But I think the ultimate purpose of life is to be. Ultimately, because ultimately we always live in the time frame that I start this life, I go to this, and I try to find meaning and do this and that and that. But ultimately, it's just being. And so I don't think we can answer that question, because there'll always be another one beyond it. But this is a question that relates to relative being, as it were. And mm-hmm. So it has a purpose, but it has no purpose simultaneously. So there is no ultimate purpose to life. We can never possibly comprehend that, I feel. But if we have a sense of meaning, then we're kind of on the right track.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
Oh, well, I've just looked my name up, Craig Hamilton Parker, on YouTube. I'm sure you'll have some links in the description, hopefully. And mm-hmm. You can look up my work on YouTube. I've also got my website at psychics.co.uk. And if people want to book readings with me there, they're very limited because I can only do so many, but I do workshops and things that people find interesting. And also, most importantly with my work at the moment, really, is I'm setting up a charitable trust, a charitable foundation in which we try to help the world, and we're trying to build a spiritual center. So anybody does look me up, I'd be grateful if you have a look at that and see what you think about what we're trying to do on that level as well.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
I think I've spoken too much, you know. I think finally, I mean, from what we've been talking about today, I didn't kind of know how direction it was going to, where we're going to be talking about the afterlife and work mm-hmm. as a medium and things like that. We kind of spoken on a spiritual level. And I think what we've kind of come out between the two of us when we've been chatting here is, I think, the idea of fearlessness, isn't it? About that mm-hmm. we shouldn't keep worrying about things. We shouldn't keep thinking about that the world's all going to fall apart around us. And I think just be happy with the world. Be happy. That's the final message. Be happy.
Greg, it has been such a pleasure and honor speaking to you, my friend. I look forward to our next conversation, and I appreciate you and everything you're doing to awaken the planet. So I appreciate you, my friend.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed. It's a real pleasure to talk to an intelligent person, open-minded person, and someone, hopefully, we're on the same vibe. So, yeah, thanks. It's been Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.